Welcome to the Alan Elkann Interviews, an unprecedented window into the minds of some of the most well-known and respected figures of the last 25 years.
Maurice Lévy is the successor of Marcel Bleustein-Blanchet. I mean, you worked together for many, many years. Marcel Bleustein-Blanchet has invented Publicis. I think it was 1926 when he started. Then he went through the radio. Then there was a war. He was in the resistance. And then after the war, he started again Publicis and made it a big success. And you joined in the 70s. And you are the man who made Publicis, a French company of advertising, marketing, and many other things. You made it international, right? And I think that now you have more than 100 countries in the world where you operate. Can you tell me a little bit about your fantastic experience? How did you develop? I mean, you have how many thousands of people now working for you?
85,000. I'm not sure it is a metric of success because it is those 85,000 families and responsibility, but it is a very large number. Telling the story is a bit complicated. It can be summarized in one sentence, and this will be maybe the end of the interview. And that sentence is, I will say it in French, I will translate it in English. Je ne savais pas que c'était impossible, et donc je l'ai fait. Yes,
you didn't know it was impossible, and therefore you did it.
Exactly. It was a kind of unconsciousness of the difficulties. When you go back to the time when we started to think about being global, it was as early as the mid-80s, before he decided to change the structure and to put me in the role of CEO. And I was starting to explain to Marcel Bleustein-Blanchet that we had to transform Publicis and to make it more global. And Marcel was reacting he was reacting negatively by saying, Maurice, what do you think you can bring to the Americans? They have invented everything. And when I was mentioning China, it's a communist country. And do you speak Mandarin? I said, no, I don't speak Mandarin, but I don't need to speak Mandarin to implement Publicis. So he was a bit skeptical about what we could do, and for good reason, because as he said, not only advertising and marketing our technique, which had been invented by the Americans. But on top of that, we were born as Publicis. He created Publicis in Paris, in France, a country which hates the l'économie libre, hates market economy. They hate what resemble to anything which is okay about capitalism. Things have changed since then.
You studied in America, right?
Yes.
As a young man.
Yeah.
Therefore, you knew well what America was, and probably the founder knew it less, even if he was somehow a kind of hero in the resistance.
But he knew, because he went to the U.S. as soon as 1929. He learned a lot from the U.S. He returned also in 1933. He visited CBS. He met with Sarnoff. He met with the people of J. Walt Thompson. He met with Gallup. He was struck on how Gallup was doing.
Because he's the first man in France who developed the technique of the polls,
Absolutely.
After the war, right?
He brought that from the US. He didn't understand how with a small group of people, you can have the image of what the whole nation could think about an election, a politician or whatever. In New York, we started, by the way, in a hotel room.
You did that?
I did it, but I was not running it. I spent some time with the guy we hired.
This was in the 80s, right?
This was 82.
And you were already very successful in France.
Oh, we were not only the largest, but we were the best, the most creative agency in France, with a reputation and a fame which were absolutely fantastic. And
but what did you do of fantastic, for instance?
What we were doing, which was making us extremely successful, we had an approach to creativity, which was very different from anyone else. Not only we were looking at the product differently in order to try to find the best advantage to what the American was calling the unique selling proposition, but to magnify that unique selling proposition. And on top of that, we are doing it with aesthetic. We were spending a lot of money on production because we wanted, as French are what we call in French, publifob, they don't like advertising. We decided that we will do the films like if it was a small movie, something with great attention to production, music, the films, the commercials that we were doing for Dime were absolutely
Dime
fantastic.
Dime was the women's stocking, right?
Yeah, the stocking, the pantyhose. It was something that we could not, at that time, show on TV in the US because the day we wanted to do it, they said, oh, impossible, these two sensual and sexual. We had not the feeling that it was that sexual, but it was, yes, there was a lot of sensuality and lots of seduction. We were famous for going off-road, using unusual routes. I will give you an example which was staggering because everyone was against at Heineken. When we were pitching the brand, it was a very small brand in France. It was the kind of beer that you find in the airport and not really in the bars and the coffee shop in Paris or in France. And they wanted to invest in France, and I was presenting to Freddy Heineken. And instead of doing what every time you see, which is three, four friends sharing a good moment together and sharing a beer, we decided that we would show that with one single individual and speaking from the screen only in the cinema theaters to the audience. And everyone said, this is crazy. This is not going to work. And what he was telling was only the quality of the beer. And speaking of the beer, exactly, he was speaking of a personality. And it has been a tremendous success. And everyone was against and saying, this is too lonely. And it's not the good image for the beer, for somebody who is drinking alone, etc.
Tell me something, Boris. How do you come to these decisions? You know, how do you go against...
Against the tide.
You know, who... Because you're very creative, because...
It's because, first, we were doing a lot of research, trying to know everything, and a kind of contrarian. I'm always looking for the other side and saying, okay, if I'm going the usual route, the only way to win is to be on that usual route, one, extremely creative, and second, over-invest, out-invest the competition. So instead of out-investing the competition, I thought, and I still think, that it's much better to outsmart the competition and to be smarter by finding a way to speak about a product, a car, furniture, shampoo, whatever it is, differently. One example, which is interesting, when we decided to launch Fructis, which is a brand from L'Oréal.
What is the name of the brand?
Fructis from Garnier, because it was coming from the fruit. And instead of doing what everyone does, shampoo is private, it is in the bathroom, we did outdoor And it was not only you alone washing your head. It was a bunch of young people were so happy, etc. And at the end, wow, they were outside washing their hair. And this was so unusual that it has kept the attention and gained the attention of all the youth market. And we had all the young newcomer, new customers coming to us.
You have to innovate yourself all the time to be
This is a quality of Publicis since its inception. When Marcel Bustin-Blanchet decided to create Publicis, he was against a giant who was owning the market, was Havas. And the only way was for him to be more clever, more original, more creative, and innovating all the time. This is the reason, and you pointed it out, that he brought the polls in order to ask the housewives, okay, we're liking about the soup or about the washing machine or about coffee or whatever, their preference, etc. So he was innovating. Not only imported the polls, but from Gallup, but much later on, at the end of the 50s, beginning of the 60s, I was not yet a publicist, he created a department which was about the idea of semiology, the science of signs, and saying people are not buying only a product, a suit or tie, but they are buying signs. Signs that represent their personality, the kind of watch that they are having, the kind of shirt, etc., etc. And the reflection of, okay, if I'm buying a product, in reality, I'm not only buying a product, I'm buying the social representation of that product. And this has been the origin of a very beautiful success story.
How did you jump into that? You were very young.
Yes.
Why did you join Publicis?
In fact, I started by accident in the advertising field because I'm an engineer. I was working on computers, programming, and I learned how to write that kind of program in machine language and in language which are extremely sophisticated and complicated. And I joined an agency to run their computer department at age 24. And very quickly after, because I had not much to do, I started to do a few other things. The first thing that I did was to write what we would call today an algorithm, which was a model for measuring the audience and simulating what a marketing plan could be and how we should use the media at the cheapest price and with the best audience possible. So I did that, and it was something which was so new that the account people and the creative people were loving to take me, I was 25 at that time, to the clients and speaking about this. And the clients were surprised to see this young guy with long hair and jeans, etc., which was quite unusual. And I became successful with the client, and I loved creativity, and I was trying always to find new ideas. And one day, the chairman of that agency, which was the number three in the market, invited me for lunch. He called me on the morning, Monday. It was beginning of Feb 1971. And he said, are you free for lunch? I would like to have lunch with you. I said, bien sûr, monsieur. Évidemment. So I was asking myself what I have done wrong. And we went for lunch. As you know, the French lunch, you eat, and it's only at the end, before you, when you have finished the main course and before attacking the cheese, that he said, you know, the CEO of the agency is going to retire in June. We had on Friday the board meeting, and we all agreed to succeed him. There was not the best person than you. A look at him, I was 29. It was an agency of 350 people. And they said, but are you sure? Why me? And he said, simply because we all agreed that you are the best in the agency. And I heard me saying, I really not thought of, it came out of me, if I'm at 29, I'm the best, I'm in the wrong agency, because I will not learn anymore. And they decided to resign. A few days after, I got a call from Publicis, and I joined the agency immediately, Publicis, to run their IT department, because I was still an IT guy also. And in those days, a pretty good one. And the way I joined was very funny, because the man who was in charge, was the second in command at Publicis, said to me, listen, I have taken responsibility for IT. I don't know a clue about it. And there is 90 chance for out of 100 that we fail. Do you want to fail with me? I said, this is the kind of proposal you can't refuse. This is a challenge. And not only we have not failed, but we had a tremendous success. Unfortunately, the building burned in 1972. It was fortunate that we changed the system, because it is that system which has saved the company. And very quickly after, Marcel was asking me to take more role, client responsibility. He decided to put me in a position of CEO of the main agency.
All this was only French.
Publicis was 80%, 75% French. And there was some small agencies in Europe.
And you then opened the world.
I started.
Then how did you do it?
The idea was there, and Marcel Bessin-Borchet was not really keen to do it. So the only thing that I have done at the beginning was to grow the company as much as we could in Europe. But as much as we could, we were, when I have been named CEO, we were in total, France and outside France, 6,000 people, mainly in France. And we were in 11 countries, and we were ranking 21 or 22 global agents in the world. So we were not in the top 10, we were not in the top 20, we were just a little bit behind. And one day, I had a lunch with a client, and a global client with whom we had a great relationship. He said during the lunch, Maurice, we love Publicis, we love you, but the world is becoming more and more global, and we cannot work only with local agencies. We have more than 100 agencies in the world. This is far too many. We will bring that to 4 global agencies. So it didn't take me a long time to understand that we will not be part of the 4. And they said, what that does mean? It will take time. Don't worry. It will be something progressive. We will not leave immediately. So listen, they said, we are not going to leave anyone. And give me 2 months and I will come back to you.
You said?
Yes.
What did you do in these 2 months?
In these 2 months, I scratched my head and tried to find a solution. And I came 2 months after with the solution. And they will tell you what the solution is all about. So I sat down with him and they said, listen, first of all, thank you. It was, if he invited me, 15th of August. You are French, 15th of August, everything is closed. People are on vacation. And he wanted absolutely to make all the decision, to announce the decision by the last week of August. So I sat down and I said, thank you, blah, 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 blah. I have a solution. He said, before you speak, I will show you. He took a piece of paper out of his pocket. show me, that is the alignment, and you are here, aligned. And they say, why have you done that? I said, because I knew that you will bring a solution. Now you tell me about your solution. And the solution was very simple. We met with the CEO of an agency which was called FCB, Footcon Building, a US agency. They were weak in Europe, strong in Latin America and in the US. We were strong in Europe, strong, much stronger in Europe than anywhere else. And I said, listen, we will have an alliance and we share client. And this would pretty good. So we did some exchange of shares, blah, blah, and we built that alliance. And that client supported and other client and all my clients decided
you entered
to
in the four, the yes, number four.
Exactly. And we were the number four. And I convinced Marcel Besson-Blanchet that this was the right thing to do. And they said, now we need to invest heavily and to become a global agency on our own right. We had this small dispute with FCB because FCB wanted to take us over.
You wanted to take them over?
I decided as a replica, as an answer to their attempt to take control of us, to do a reverse takeover. But I had no intention whatsoever to take them over. But that ended up with the dispute. We went to arbitration, blah, 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 blah. We won. And it was something incredible. I don't know if we have time for that, but in short, as they wanted to take control of us, they tried to, in French, discredit myself. So what they did is to hire a private detective to see what was my prototype, if I had, I don't know, some story that they could use with the client to show that either I was living with mistresses or I had something wrong in my life or getting kickback or whatever. They didn't find anything, but I have been followed. My communication have been taped. My hotel rooms have been visited. My paperwork when I was leaving them in the hotel room have been copied. Just incredible what they did, exactly in a bad thriller, in a bad movie. This was just incredible, the way they had behaved. And we demonstrated that we were in good faith, that they were not in good faith, and we won the arbitration. And from that moment, we decided that we will run to create our own global network. And Marcel, unfortunately, died in April 1996. I worked extremely hard, and in September 1996, I made a trip going to Montreal. I bought an agency, all the negotiations had been made before, but I announced this acquisition. And then I went to Mexico and we announced the agency bought in Mexico. And then I went to Sao Paulo, we announced the acquisition. From Sao Paulo, I went to Singapore and then to Manila and then to Thailand, Bangkok, etc. And it has been incredible journey where I was acquiring 2-3 agencies per month. Crazy. Somewhere.
And now they are all publicity.
Yes, absolutely. This was, at that time, it was a combination of names. So there was Norton Agency or the Romero Agency or BCP or Eurocarp, whatever. I was first adding the name of publicity and then I was dropping the other name.
But you were a shareholder of Publicis?
No. I became a shareholder of Publicis in 98. I was getting some options, but you know, in the French system, the option for a CEO
not very big.
It's not very big, quite thin. But the youngest daughter of Marcel Besson-Blanchet decided to sell her stake in Publicis, the stake she inherited. And she decided, because she was not very happy with some family aspect, that she would sell either to a competitor or to me. And at that time, buying her stake was too expensive. I had not the money and not the possibility. So what I decided to do was to have a plan by which I will ask some investors to take a small stake, a small part. Then I offered the personnel to participate at a very interesting condition and financed partially by the banks. And personally, I bought Lupus the rest. What people didn't want to buy, I guaranteed that this is something I will take. I was wrong. I should have taken much more. But I took mortgage with putting all my little property. I had just an apartment. And in order to guarantee the mortgage, I had to pledge the apartment.
But then it became bigger and bigger, right?
And then it became very simple. It has been multiplied by 100. That's simple.
So Marcel,
the value has
so
been
Marcel
multiplied.
So Marcel Boucher has created Publicis, and you made it a big thing.
I made it a global thing, and moving from the 22nd position to the third one. And in market cap, number one, number two.
And who are your clients? You cannot say, or you can?
Yes, I can. Nestlé, you have Unilever, Procter & Gamble, L'Oréal, you have Renault, you have a company you know quite well, Stellantis, GM, Bank of America, Citi, Samsung.
But what do? You act as consultants? They don't have their own?
We do three things. And I have to go back a little bit to the end of the 90s, 98, 99, where I decided that I will invest heavily in digital. And then there has been the bubble burst. And I have made, a few years after, the first acquisition in digital of a certain magnitude. And I have invested heavily in the sector, which is the most innovative for our district. So we are the most advanced in digital, in technology, and in data.
Even
and data
competition
analysis.
With Amazon.
We don't compete against Amazon, but one of our operations develop website for e-commerce. So e-commerce websites are developed by one of our operations, which is called Publicis.Sapient. We don't compete with Facebook or with Google because we are advising our client to invest in Google and Facebook. But we are competing with Accenture. We are competing with Deloitte. We are competing, obviously, with WPP, Omnicom, IPG, and Dentsu, Havas, etc. Our largest client, as I said, I have mentioned a few names, but when we started to work with Samsung, they were moving from manufacturing a lot of things, a lot of telephones, but not the telephone. And they were not yet at the level where they are. And we helped them becoming a global leader in the field of mobile phone, for example.
What do you do for that?
The first thing that
what
we do.
What is Maurice Levy added value in all that? What do you invent?
Beyond what I can do personally, advising a client, because I'm involved sometimes in the relationship to that degree, including now, it happens that I'm receiving a call from a client and I'm sitting with a client to looking at some issues and helping the client to make some decision or investment or in other area, in advertising or marketing, on product, on management. But that is something which is relatively specific. If I had an added value in the way I run the company, was probably in three areas. The first one is the vision. Without being immodest, I have seen before the competition the role that internet will play in our
That's office. Because you were an engineer.
Probably. Right?
That's because of your...
Yeah, probably because of my background. That is probably what happened. And I saw that. So the vision is clearly something for which I had given a lot of myself, a lot of time, energy, thinking, and I brought some interesting ideas which has transformed the company. That is one aspect. The second is leadership. When you have a company that you are transforming and you are acquiring a lot of people, of organization, of brands, we were Publicis, we acquired Saatchi, we acquired Leobernet, we acquired Digitas, Sapient. So, and all this, we did it without raising 1 cent of capital. We paid sometime in a combination of shares and cash, and most of the time in cash. And that's the reason why we are extremely, extremely serious about the cost and managing the cost. And last thing is to pick the right people. I have been involved in many campaigns. I have been involved in the choice of the positioning or in how we are going to shoot or to choose some creative or whatever. But my key role was much more about the strategy and the execution, because a strategy without execution remains just a dream. And execution without a vision leads you nowhere. It's tactical, and you don't build something which has a long future. And if you want to build that, you need the combination of the vision, the strategy, and the execution.
But all these different agencies you have around the world, as you said at the beginning, the French didn't like advertising, and so you had to find an idea to make them change their mind, or at least to understand them and tell. How do you operate? In each country, there is a different way, or there is a Publicis kind of Bible, a kind of way of operating?
Now, that is a very, very good question, because it is at the core of our difference and how we have operated. When we started the globalization, the trend of most advertisers was to build global campaigns. I want to send exactly the same message to everyone on the planet. And it was good for them because they had agencies everywhere and they could say to the client, it will be the same campaign, they will adapt it locally. And you will be sure that your message is carried everywhere the same way. Fighting against this was impossible. First, because we had not the implementation, we had not the agencies. And I thought that we would have to acquire, it would be complicated. And on top of that, I was not sure that the professional answer of a global campaign was the right answer. It could work for some very top-level brands in those days, all the jewelry, the watches, Rolex, etc. This is fine. But when it comes to food, coffee, or the way you are selling powder, detergent, it was not exactly the same, or shampoo. So you had to address the diversity of the people. And as early as in the beginning of the 90s, I was thinking that they came with an idea that is mine, and I'm very proud of it, which is La Différence, and Viva La Différence. And the idea was each country is different. Each culture is different. The people are different. And we should accept the differences of the people. And not only we should accept them, but it should not be a burden. It should be something which we should celebrate. And we went on that concept of Viva la Différence. And I was telling a client, listen, with your international campaign, what you will do is to scratch the surface, because all the people who are at the same level of education, who are a little bit westernized, etc., will understand what you are doing. But when you go deep in the country, you will have some difficulties. He said, okay, show me. I said, give me a country, I show you. And I showed that. I showed that, and the most beautiful example was Coca-Cola. Overnight, I won Coca-Cola on 40 plus countries. Simply, simply.
You saw Coca-Cola in different ways.
Yeah, I said, listen, in Russia, it was the beginning of, after the perestroika, Yeltsin was on board, etc. If you want to sell Coke to the people who understand Western, you will have 10%, 15% of the population. So what I suggest, we go with a team for 6 weeks in Russia. We will look at the country. We will go to see the peasant. We will go to see the workers. We will go in Siberia, everywhere. And we will come back with material and we will decide what will be the best. And it has been a tremendous success. They multiplied the sales by 3 or 4 overnight. And they decided then to give us all European countries. And it has been
Since you started, the advertising world has changed a lot.
There is one thing which has not changed, only one, which is the human input on the idea. That's the only thing which has not changed. And there is a lot of things which have changed, which is society, culture, music, movie, technology.
So that's what you have to do, to follow everything. And how do you do it?
First, you have to have the people to do it. And that is a permanent rejuvenation of your workforce. It's something that you need to have the people who understand the new languages, the new habits, and you have to make it working with the people who are more elder and they have a better understanding of the mechanism of advertising, and the combination is something which works. Everything is about alchemy. And if there is something which is the most complicated task that I had to fulfill, was how to bring together the technologists, the engineers, the data analysts, all those people who are left brain with the creative, right brain. And it's not only a different culture, they are rational, it's simple, there is science, it's something which should work this way. They have a different kind of education, and they are in a different world, the geeks, etc. And the creative, they are more artists, they have antennas to understand the society, they know how to communicate, and the communication between the two is very complicated. And the way to bring them together has been to change our organization. And our organization, which has been extremely successful and which is that of the industry, was to work in silo. The media agency, the creative agency, the promotion agency, the digital agency, and on the CRM agency.
Yeah, because there are so many different publics, right?
Exactly, and so many different techniques.
The young do not watch TV. The old don't use as much as the young, the internet.
It's not only different audiences.
Newspapers are no more as so important, no?
Yeah, and it is also the technique which is different. And in 2015, we organized a process, and they invited first my COMEX, my executive committee. Sorry, COMEX is in French, Comité Exécutif, EXCOM, my executive committee, to work on what the future organization should be. And we have been working on how to improve, how to be more effective, more efficient, more productive, more creative, to bring all the things together, all the kind of things that you can imagine that we do. So we started with roughly 20 people. Then we added some 50 people. Then we added another layer. And we ended up in a seminar for a full week at the end of September 2015 with roughly 250 people, 250 executives with a P&L role, with client role, with responsibility. So they were really extremely precious in the organization with very strong responsibility. And these are the people who are running the company. And then we added young executives. So they were already in a role of executive, but they were in at the age of 29, 30. And then we added millennials at the below 25. We melted all that. We invited some great people to come to explain the new world. So we had Sergey Brin from Google. We had the CTO of Facebook. We had Mark Andreessen from Andreessen Horowitz. We had plenty of those people. Mark Benioff sharing their experience and answering the question of the room. That aspect was absolutely tremendous. And this was in the morning. And the afternoon, we had workshops and people were working together on subjects which were, okay, how do we go to market? What should be the organization? What should be the concept of the future? Blah, 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 blah. You can imagine. We also had a professor of change management of Harvard Business School. And she told us how she is teaching the student about change management. At the end, the most formidable ideas came from the millennials. Why? Because there is no censorship. They say what they think. When you are an adult in an organization, yes, we should do that. Oh, no, we tried again. We tried several times. It didn't work. Maybe we should try that. Oh, no, we know it will not work. And that guy will not accept. And you are censoring yourself. When you have those young people, they don't care. They have no idea what has been the other experience. And they are going. So some of the ideas were completely realistic and we have not been able to implement that. But the most important idea, which was, by the way, the name that I gave to that seminar and to the whole organization, was the power of one. The power of one is what? We have many assets. We have plenty of things. And we don't bring them together in a seamless way for a client. So the client is not benefiting from all our assets. And people are competing inside instead of having the feeling that they're working in the same direction. So we killed the internal competition. And that is the concept on which we are working today, which has changed dramatically because what we have done is to break down the silos. And we have a mantra, which is, and this is something that I created, you ask about my input. No silo, no solo. We don't want people to work solo.
Right.
No bozo. If you are a bozo, go elsewhere. There is no room for bozos. If you want to play solo, you can do probably some great things, but at the end of the day, you will damage the company and you will damage the team because the team will feel bad about the way you are behaving. Even when you are Michael Jordan, or Ronaldo, or Mbappe, you need a team if you want to perform.
Right, and you don't have to humiliate. Now, I guess in your lifetime, and there has been a lot of this, there are words that come up and they mean what in French would be called l'air du temps. No? For instance, at the moment, there is this word sustainability, right? And everything has to be sustainable, which is probably right. And this is where companies are changing at the moment. No, so we live in a time where there is sustainability in one side. The other side, we want to go to Mars and to the moon. And in the third side, we have to rely to artificial intelligence, right? So to live in a world like this and to do your job must be quite difficult, right? To please and to find a way to promote all these different things, that the world of today and certainly will be the beginning of the world of tomorrow. This has happened before in your lifetime, right? But how do you face these kind of main changes in the way of thinking, living, planning life and investments and all that? I mean, even, for instance, the cars that will change to electrical cars or hydrogen or, you know, all these kind of things.
And the most important issue is people. You're right. This is probably the most difficult thing that we have to deal. We have been going through a lot of progress from the horses to the plane and the cars. And you remember the word of Henry Ford. Okay, what your consumer think about the car? So if I had to put a question to the consumer, he will tell me, I want the fastest horse. He was not thinking about building a car. So the problem we have when you look at all the challenges that we have to face is how to make sure that everyone in our organization is embracing that future. And I will give you a few examples. The first hurdle is the resistance to change. And Goethe has said, human beings are animals of habits. So if you change the habits, you create a problem to the human being. So how can you do that without creating a huge problem and generating anxiety? And people will say, okay, what will happen to me? This is a new world, and I'm not prepared for that new world. The second aspect is that when you look at tech, digital, internet, AI, and you have the population who is coming from advertising, you remember what happened with some stories which have been told on TV and other movies regarding the way people were having an idea by smoking, having a glass of whiskey, and then suddenly they have the idea. And these people were coming from that myth and tell them, okay, now you have to do data analysis. You have to think about artificial intelligence, we will predict, et cetera, et cetera. I said, I don't know what artificial intelligence is about, or tech that will transform your business and the way you are operating. So how to upskill and reskill those people and to make sure that they are understanding this new world in a way which is quite confident and they don't feel aggressed and that this world is not aggressive to them. And that is the most important challenge.
Are they capable to change?
Some, yes, some will not. And we have to face it.
Look at fashion, you know, the magazines are over more or less.
Yeah,
Instagram or other things like that are the new way.
Exactly, that they cannot adapt. And you are taking some very good example. Look at what happened to the press. You have the memories where you have the family starting the breakfast, there was the newspaper, the father was opening the newspaper, etc. The kids were eating their cereals with a glass of milk. And now we say, well, milk is cereals, too much sugar, newspaper is not there.
Yeah.
There is a TV in the kitchen, and there everyone is looking at the mobile phone to look at Facebook, Instagram, and the Google News or whatever. So the world has changed, the habit has changed, and people believe, by the way, that they are extremely well informed because they have access to a lot of things, but in reality they are ill informed because there are a lot of fake news, and because there are those fake news and they trust more the friend and the people who don't know anything than a news channel or whatever. So in this world, the most difficult aspect is to make sure that we are bringing to the people the quality of life that they need and the quality of understanding through education, training, pampering, mentoring, coaching. And this is something, and the caring is probably more important than the rest. And on top of all those issues, there is one other issue that you have not tackled, which is becoming paramount, which is the issue of gender equality, respect for all the differences, and diversity. And you have to do that sincerely, with authenticity. Otherwise, people will see that, yes, this is a decision which has been made to be politically correct, but the reality...
So you have to be honest.
And the reality that you don't believe it. And you have to be honest. And this is part of the culture that you are implementing. And either the culture is sincere and honest and you are really making the right decision. For example, if somebody is complaining because he's gay and he's not treated, you have to go deep to understand what has been the situation in that country, how he has been treated, his complaint is right or not, and you have to do it with a lot of objectivity. And if he feels that, that he is right, that you have done the right thing, the word is spread in the organization. People know that. One thing that I will tell you, which was quite unusual in those days, because it is in the beginning of 2003, woman came to see me, said, you know, I have to speak to you directly because I'm working with Mr. X and I feel a real discomfort. He has not aggressed me, but he has touched here by accident or not accident. And it's not only me. So she was telling, okay, he has not raped her. He has not harassed her, but he has a behavior which was creating the discomfort. So what I did was to very nicely and discreetly interviewed a few women in that department. And I discovered that they had all the same discomfort. It was one word, it was one gesture, it was a way to behave. And I called the guy and I had a conversation with him and they said, listen, this is what I have discovered. And, oh, you are not going to pay attention to that, okay. And you are not coming, you are not becoming American. We are French, and okay, it's just a seduction. I decided to fire him, despite the fact that he was very successful, because he was not going to change. This symbolic act, without an aggression, has been tremendously important for the whole organization. And I think that when you claim something, you have to have a corpus of rules and a behavior which are both in accordance with what you are claiming. To say, we are for respecting the people, for their dignity, you have to create the safe environment and to make sure that it is safe.
Do you think that going to marketing and promotion, publicity, advertising and all that, polls, it's a good job for young people? And what would you suggest them to do? After you had this brilliant career yourself and you seem to be so young in a way, I mean, in the sense that you are aware exactly what's important. Nowadays, in one thing, the other and the other, and therefore able to advise and help your clients according to the time in which we are living, right? But what would you advise a young person who starts to do?
I'm probably the wrong guy to give an advice because I'm so passionate about this industry and the craft. Working on an idea, I have seen an idea 2 days ago from a team, and the team said, unfortunately, we will not be able to make it happen because there are people who are against. So I decided that I will make everything possible in order that this idea become true and become real. So why do I love it? First, because we are working on something which is human. We are speaking about feelings about passion, about perception, about reaction, behavior, attitude. All this is the impact that a campaign can have on an individual. What do we try to do when we are doing campaign is to change the behavior of some people and to make that behavior going to an action, which is to buy a product that we want to sell. But at the same time, if we do it properly, we deliver a message which is much broader, which is about human values, which is about the future, and we can use our talent to do good to the world and to help improving state of the world. It is also a place where you are at a kind of crossroad, un carrefour. Look at here we are in Paris, and next there is Place de l'Étoile, the Arc de Triomphe. And you have many avenues, and the Arc de Triomphe is at the center. You have the avenue of business, because what we do is to help business growing, to sell more product profitably. You have the avenue of people. We are addressing this to people. And we are not addressing to masses. We are addressing to million times one individual. Then you have the world of media. With the world of media, you have access to information, to journalists, to politicians. So you are at the crossroad, which is quite interesting. Then you have to realize a movie or a commercial. So you will have to work with artists. So you will have to work with the future Steven Spielberg. He did some commercials. Claude Lelouch, he did some commercials. And many, many, many others, artists who play. George Clooney with Nespresso. And then you have to work with innovation, new technique, new media, internet, digital, data. What is the data? What do I learn from the data? Artificial intelligence. So it's just like if you are a small boy in a grocery shop where there is a lot of sweets that you want to get, and you move from one to another, and all the tastes are there, all the good things, and you are just taken by that. So this Maurice industry Lévy is absolutely fantastic.
So Maurice Lévy is a passionate man, right?
Oh, yes. And that's passion in everything I do.
So this is the key of your success.
I don't know. Honestly, I have never thought about it. I will tell you two things. The first one, I have never, ever, ever in my life thought about my career, what I will do next. There is people who have a career plan. And they remember when I was hiring people, mon plan de carrière, my career plan is, say, okay.
Go somewhere else.
You have to go somewhere else. Because if you want the career plan, this is not. If you want surprises, if you want something unexpected, if you want to work passionately with clients, with consumers, with artists, come with us and be daring. So that's the first thing. The second, I have been always fearless about my job. If I were to lose my job, too bad, but this is something I could be sanctioned, but I had to dare. I had absolutely to dare. If I was not daring, we would still be
a little French.
A superb French agency, not a little one.
No,
magnificent, because Marcel has created something which was magnificent, but would not be what we are today, which is one of the most valued holding company in our field. And what I like the best is the joy when I see work which is changing the course of action of a brand and offering to the consumer a satisfaction beyond the use of a product. If it is just the satisfaction of the product and there is not a mental advantage, a psychological advantage, what I call in French la gratification psychologique différentielle, I have done only half of the job.
Thank you very much for your time, Maurice Lévy. This has been a long, very interesting lesson of your career, your life, and what it means to create this kind of empire, you know, in the world of advertising and marketing and life and so many other things. So thank you very much for being with
thank
us.
Thank you.
Alan Elkann Interviews.